Hello, U.S. history students. Welcome in. Here we got lesson 5.4, the age of big business in America. We talked last time about the start of the Industrial Revolution, which is, of course, this global process. And in America, we see during this period of time, the second half of the 19th century, we see this process of industrialization come into full blossom. And the concepts we're going to learn about here today, when we process them through our filter, through our storyline of the blessing and the curse, I think they really come to life. And I think there's a lot of richness in what we're going to do here today. So I'm excited to see what you guys report back after reflecting on this, what you guys have to say about this material. So our learning targets, I can explore the blessings and the curses in the growth of big business. There's, of course, both, right? I can explain the emergence of labor unions, which are kind of like a counterbalance to big business in certain ways. Along the way, we're assessing America's rise to greatness and doing this through the lens of being a biblical seeker of justice. Let's jump in. The central figures in this story are these people who were sometimes called the captains of industry, right? The titans of their day. You know, today we might have Mark Zuckerberg or Jeff Bezos, and in those days you have Andrew Carnegie and John Rockefeller and J.P. Morgan and folks like this. These are people who sort of sat atop these mega industries in the late 19th century. They were wealthy, they were powerful like no Americans had ever been before. Their wealth and their power was really kind of astounding. Adjusted for inflation, Rockefeller is probably the wealthiest American in history, perhaps the wealthiest person in history. Like these people commanded immense wealth. All of them rose from obscurity. None of them was, you know, born with a silver spoon in their mouth or anything like this. So, guys, I want to tell you it's really worth knowing just enough to kind of connect Carnegie, steel, of course, and steel is essential in the growth of cities and the growth in industries. Rockefeller, oil, right? So oil for petroleum, for fuel, of course, for kerosene, for making lanterns, for lubricants, for industrial purposes, for all this kind of stuff. J.P. Morgan, banking. You can't have capitalism without capital. You need banks for that capital, for that startup money. And so Morgan and the banking industry, Vanderbilt and the railroad industry. All these industries are essential to industrialization, right? And these guys dominated those industries. So they are all kind of that rugged individualism story. They all kind of embody that in a very real way. They create and control thousands of jobs. They employ millions of people. Millions of Americans were on their payroll. They raise the standard of living by providing cheap kerosene, cheap, affordable fuel, loans that people could afford, right? Or literally the steel that's being built is being built by these quality products. They provide that for them. But we're going to see there's downsides or concerns. Benefits. Let's do the blessings first. If you're trying to understand what makes these guys tick, what makes someone like Carnegie or Rockefeller tick, what drives them, you know, the easy answer is greed, right? Okay, well, sure. By the way, that's everybody. So anyway, let's get more specific than that, right? I'd say capitalism and Christianity. These are like the two ideas. And of course, we've talked capitalism and Christianity are not perfect fits. But these are the two ideas that really kind of animate these captains of industry types. They are looking for efficiencies in business. How can we cut costs? How can we save money? How can I produce this? How can I get my prices lower to undercut my competition to win, right? They are after, they want to, capitalism means like you need to provide a service that people want to buy that's better than your competitor. Or as we'll find out sometimes, you'll find ways to crush your competitor in another way. Vanderbilt was obsessed with like bringing down the price of his products, of his things. And when you do that, when you're like bringing down the price of, when you're sort of like forcing businesses to pay, you know, when you're forcing businesses into these efficiencies on your rail lines, in the end, you can pass on that savings to consumers, right? And so because he's such a penny pincher in his railroad industry, that ends up bringing down the price of a barrel of flour, right? Because of these sort of the way they're running these in thrifty ways. You know, at the same time, they're saying we want to be thrifty in how much we pay people. We're not going to just pay people extra money because they have a sob story or because we feel like being nice. Like, they want thrift. They're like, we want the bottom line to mean we have a low price item for consumers. Carnegie in particular articulates this idea, and many others embrace it and espouse it as well. That's called the gospel of wealth. And the gospel of wealth idea is just that, you know, wealth is a blessing from God, and we could agree with that. He said wealth is not bad in and of itself, and I'd say, well, let's talk about that, but in general, I would agree with that. And Carnegie said, you know, when God gives us wealth, it is our responsibility to not sort of cling tightly to it, but to give it away. And so he says, I'm not going to give it away through just exorbitant wages, but like when I have amassed wealth, I will give it back to society. So Carnegie basically says, I will give it back in ways that don't benefit an individual person. Like, don't give an individual person $1,000. That has kind of deforming effects, actually. But what you can do is, if a community wants help to build a library or a museum or a concert hall, then we'll do that. The Carnegie Hall is the most famous example, and the one in New York is the most famous one, but honestly, there's thousands of Carnegie Halls. If you go to my wife's hometown of Virginia, Minnesota, you can find the Carnegie Library and their own Carnegie Hall and their city hall built by money offered by Andrew Carnegie. Now, that was sort of tied to the steel industry. That's a mining town up there. But Carnegie just says, if communities need help, they come to me. I will furnish things that sort of enrich civic life. I give that money back, all right? That's a blessing. That's a benefit. And a lot of people who are sort of like love this idea of like sort of penny-pinching, Scrooge-type, miserly folks forget the fact that Rockefeller and Carnegie gave exorbitantly to these sort of civic funds. You know, these guys are also pioneering new ways of doing business. Like, business itself is undergoing changes. Not every business is owned by one single person who controls all of this. Sometimes businesses, a new model of business ownership became corporations. And corporations are really essential. Sometimes today people use the word corporation interchangeably with just a big business. But a big business isn't necessarily a corporation. A corporation means it's a business that is owned not by one figure, but by many people who own stock in that company. They are stockholders. And so a corporation takes like its, you know, it's like this is the company, this is ownership of the company, and it sort of cuts that up, chops it up into thousands of small pieces, and then sells it. And if the value of that company rises, right, if it becomes more and more profitable, then all those pieces of ownership, all that stock, increases in value. And so people purchase money, they purchase stock in that company, and then that money from their purchase, if they purchase stock for, let's say, $10 a share, then all that money flows back to the board, the people who control the company, that flows back as capital. That's money that they can spend right now. That sort of frees up money. And then they can use that money to invest in something like a factory. Factories aren't cheap. If you're just waiting for someone to show up and pull out their wallet and say, here's the money for a factory, you're going to be waiting a long time. But a corporate model where you sort of go public or you sell ownership of your company, as long as you are returning money to your stockholders, like as long as you're maintaining your profit, this is a way of freeing up more money that you can spend. And then you need to spend money to make money. Monopolies. Now, these guys, one way that these fellows like Carnegie, Rockefeller, J.P. Morgan were oftentimes at odds with the old ideas of American free enterprise is that their vision was to dominate their industry, right? Like, get control of the entire steel industry or the entire oil industry or the entire rail industry in a huge chunk of the country. When one company gains complete control of a product or service, that's called a monopoly. Guys, monopolies are not that great for consumers, right? Now, if the company is just amazing, spectacular, they just provide the best stuff, maybe you could argue you can live with it. But in general, a monopoly means there is no competition, right? That pillar of free enterprise isn't present because there's no competition. And then that can mean that maybe the quality isn't quite what you want it to be because that one company decides the quality or that one company decides the price. Monopolies are going to be a big struggle here in the years to come. We'll see that in history. A trust is kind of like a de facto monopoly, a behind-the-scenes monopoly, right? When one big company gains control through stock purchases or just some general leverage, when they gain control over smaller companies, and effectively that one big company now has a monopoly, all right? So you can, in general, you can use the term monopoly and trust interchangeably. They mean about the same thing, and for our purposes, it'd be fine if you're using them interchangeably. It is like one mega company that has no competition. I don't have a good, maybe Amazon is a good comparison today where it's just like they are just, the weight of Amazon on everybody else is so heavy, they can dominate, right? The profits, the size of businesses are expanding like never before in history. And you're saying, like, look at the economic productivity that's happening. Look at the wealth that's being generated. Oh my gosh. Now, many people would say, let's throw a party, right? Or let's celebrate what we've unlocked in creation. There are downsides, though. There's curses that go with this, right? So, look, these companies are providing innovative and quality products, right? These are guys who sort of rose up through the ranks themselves, right? They are wealthy, they're powerful, but in some ways, it's fair to say, is this too much, right? Like the share of wealth owned by the small cluster of people is unlike anything, forget in American history, in human history. These guys have such influence in society, it's really not even debatable that they were more powerful than any given 19th century president in the second half of the 19th century. Who's the most powerful person in the country? It probably wasn't, you know, James Garfield. It was probably someone like John Rockefeller or Andrew Carnegie, right? And they aren't elected. There's no checks and balances on them, right? In fact, when they're a monopoly, there really is no check and balance at all. And how does the public have a say? It's kind of a weird deal. It's fair to sort of say, I don't know what I think about this, or I wonder. Companies this big could extort favors from states. They could say, you know, well, Wisconsin's going to offer us this crazy big tax break and this benefit and this. Minnesota, are you going to do that for us? If you don't, then we're going to pull out our stuff and do this over here. Like, they could sort of leverage states off each other to get like crazy sweetheart deals that other smaller companies could never get. These big companies could just really bulldoze their way through city governments and get out of this regulation or that regulation or get out of this tax or that tax. They could just really press down and get what they wanted out of them. And in general, they just sort of said to the federal government, I don't think you guys are going to do anything about this, right? Like, we defy you to do much about this. And in the second half, in this period of time, from the end of the Civil War till 1900, the mood of the federal government was more or less like, yeah, I don't know what we're going to do. I don't know what we can do. These companies did not play nicely with other businesses. They crushed competition, right? Vanderbilt would do this all the time. He would like undercut a smaller competing railroad emerges. Vanderbilt would say, well, then you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to bring my rates for my rail line way down here, and you're going to try and compete with that? You can't compete with that. You're a new business. You're a new startup. If you try and compete with me on these levels, you're going to run out of money. Fact of the matter is, I'm not going to run out of money. And once you go, boop, you disappear because you can't compete with me there, then my rates float back up. Right? You're underselling, you're undercutting, you do what you've got to do to eliminate competition. And it's fair to say, as a consumer, is that good for me? Is it good when like these big companies can get favors that they want, any favor they want from the government? It starts breeding a lot of corruption. They can drive competition out of business. The treatment of workers is really not great, as we'll get into. Like, what do I think of this, right? Is this good for us, right? Is this benefiting me economically? Right? Is this a great American story that I should celebrate or that I should be worried about? Is it a blessing or a curse? It's complicated. Labor unions arise as like a counter movement to the big business. In some ways, they are kind of a balance. Now, I don't think they're a total equal balance, but it's like labor unions do have this thing of like sort of balancing it a little bit more or somewhat. Now, why did labor unions arise? Well, because conditions were atrocious. The conditions in industrial jobs were conditions that none of you would ever stand and that no one that you love would, you would never want them to experience or deal with. It was a different time, but it was just, objectively speaking, it was miserable, right? So average workers in a factory, let's say, work 12-hour days, 6 days a week. All right, you get no real breaks, the ventilation is poor, the conditions are dangerous, accidents are common, there is no workers' compensation, so if you get your fingers pulled off, well, gee, you know, I'm sorry, I bet that hurt, right? And if you can't work now, you know, there's probably another, like, immigrant guy out there who has all 10 fingers and he can work, and so see you later, and we're going to bring in that guy to do this work. Like, it's, the benefits are just non-existent. The protections were non-existent. Now, people took the jobs because, you know, again, immigrants are flooding into our shores at this point, and they're here for the work, right? So it's like they're taking the jobs, but the conditions are just really shabby. And it's fair to say, how long can people work in conditions like this? Some companies would say, if you work in this factory, you have to live in this company town, which is like a barracks, like a college campus. You live in this barracks, and this is where you have to live, and you pay rent to us, and we'll actually just dock that rent right out of your paycheck. And if you need to buy stuff, you should buy your supplies and your food and your clothing from our company stores, and you know what, we'll actually just dock that fee right out of your paycheck. And so sooner or later, your paycheck is shrinking, and you're living on these sort of places, these barracks where you're supposed to live, and shopping in these company stores, and it's, you know, it's fair to say that there's the level of ripoff here is pretty striking. So labor unions arise as a response to that. Workers recognize, if I go in and I say, I don't like this and I think it should change, they go, you're fired, see ya, right? As an individual, you have no power. Your power comes from collective bargaining, saying, we've decided to unite, to collectivize here as these workers, to unite a labor union, and we want to demand together higher wages or improved working conditions or some combination of both. All right, you see this image here that is today just sort of common sense, but this is a negotiating ploy for labor unions, what they're asking for. Not a negotiating ploy, it's like what their demand was. 8 hours for work, 8 hours for rest, 8 hours for leisure, right? And today we go, yeah, that's fair, right? But this is sort of, they were trying to get to this point from what it was before. Normally, ownership of a factory or management didn't want a labor union to form, because that complicates things, and that means it's going to, you know, your factory and operating it is going to become more expensive. Once a labor union has formed, if it has happened, then it's generally in everybody's interest to come to a resolution, right? It's not in people's interest typically to strike, because then people are going without money or productivity is not happening. So like that's a process that was like, once it was there, then it was in everybody's interest to figure it out. And unions were disproportionately made up of people new to the United States, right? Like this is a period of just peak immigration into the United States, in particular from Southern and Eastern Europe. So all these Italian folks that are arriving, there's still many Irish and Germans showing up. There are Russians, there are Jews from Eastern Europe arriving. And these people are disproportionately making up the roles of the labor unions. Also, there is just sort of a funny thing about like labor unions attracting political oddballs or rejects. Anarchists or socialists would tend to sort of attach themselves to labor unions. So if you're looking for political radicals in a given city, I'd say go to some labor union meetings. You'll find the political radicals. You'll find the people who are sort of politically out there a little bit. They tend to attach themselves to here as like some way of weakening the status quo. All right. So let's just be advised of that as we go ahead. Sometimes labor unions were associated with strikes, of course. Sometimes these strikes turned violent. Sometimes they turned really violent. There were a series of like strikes that got way out of hand in the 1880s and 1890s. For a lot of Americans, they looked at these strikes like the Haymarket Square riot in Chicago, and they said, these labor unions have too many crazies in them. Forget this stuff, right? Like, they should like crack some skulls and break these unions up. Some Americans came to that place. Many labor unions had to distance themselves from some of the radicals. There's like, in some ways, guys, think of it like a pot. All these pressures that are happening here in this new industrial age are resulting in some, the lid of the pot is starting to rattle just a bit, and this is evidence of that. We'll pick up on that more in Unit 6. A last thought. Let's return real quickly here and look at this whole sequence, all this stuff from an African-American perspective. African Americans are in a kind of a no man's land, I put it here, where there's no doubt that especially in the North, but also in the South, there are new economic opportunities here that are that look brighter than sharecropping, that's for sure. And so it's like there's a chance for some improvement in our economic situation. At the same time, this is happening simultaneously with like the darkening of horizons that happens with like the clampdown of Jim Crow and Jim Crow segregation. And so it's like both are happening at the same time. New economic opportunities at the simultaneous with this like clampdown of bitter discrimination and violence, racial violence. So what do we make of this? As an African-American, how do I navigate our way through this? And there's two figures that really have, they're two black figures who are both interest, they're both champions of equality and civil rights, but they just have kind of different approaches to it. Booker T. Washington was born in Virginia as a slave. He's educated in a freeman's school. He becomes very educated, a great writer, orator. He's kind of the inheritor of the mantle of Frederick Douglass in certain ways. He founds the Tuskegee Institute for blacks to educate blacks, particularly in industrial skills. And Booker T. Washington's position or his message to African Americans is this: look. Let's control what we can control. Let's make ourselves economically indispensable, just economically essential to America by developing our industrial economic skills. Let's like be the people who work in these factories and work these jobs. And when we become economically essential and when we sort of gain esteem in the eyes of white America there, then we will gain the political equality that we have been promised but has been taken away from us. And so it's an accommodationist position. Like, we're just gonna have to wait, right? We're gonna trade our political rights for now for some economic status. And when our economic status improves, then we will cash that in for our political rights. That's just, we're gonna have to make a bargain. And maybe it's a bargain with the devil. Maybe it's unfair that we have to make this. But he says it's really the only viable path, because if we start barking and hollering, then what's gonna happen is lynchings. What's gonna happen is we will become the victims of Klan racist violence, right? And so this is our path forward. W.E.B. Du Bois, who's born in the North, who has experienced sort of the promises of civil rights, says, I disagree totally, right? Why wait for what is constitutionally ours? Why wait for what is promised to us by the United States government? We have to agitate, we have to act, we have to press people, we have to make them uncomfortable to get what is ours. We shouldn't wait here and sort of meekly and politely ask for something that we are entitled to, that are our rights. Like, it's overdue, it's far overdue. We need to act and press now. There's sort of two voices on the ear, you know, on the shoulders of African Americans, these two different approaches. They agree in the ultimate cause, but they differ because the moment is complex. There is also a quiz we're going to do in class next time. There's a Kahoot challenge that you can use to prepare for that. So all these things, this is like the reflective capstone work. So scrapbook page, reflection question, Kahoot challenge. These are things you can be doing now to sort of, this is the you do portion of the lesson. All right, students. I enjoyed talking about this. I'm sorry I couldn't be there with you, but I will be with you next time. Any questions, email me. And otherwise, take care. Good luck the rest of the class.